Aristotle's theory of happiness, right? Because you're in love. First of all, being in a position where you're looking for money, it's fair to point out that Aristotle was one of the first people to receive a grant. He received about 800 talents of gold from Alexander for his research, and he had people in the field looking for biology, philosophy, like just getting to know even the flora, fauna. He was one of the primary people to start this. In my past life, I wish I was him. Because $4 million is not a joke for a grant. Yeah. But ideally, his theory of happiness is based on his ethical philosophy. His views on ethics revolve around the concept of virtue and the pursuit of human flourishing. Now, this human flourishing is what I'm going to break down, and that's what we call eudaimonia. Now, before we go into it, I'm just going to say a short summary. Eudaimonia and happiness is a two veins. Now, one of the songs that I really liked was Pursuit of Happiness by Kid Cudi. Pursuit of Happiness is where you primarily seek material things so that you come into a place of comfort. In our modern times, we call it the soft life. But we don't pursue happiness because it's fleeting. You get to the point where you've gotten what you're looking for, and then you realize that, okay, now what? It's over. You got the girl. Now what? You got the house. Now what? The G-Wag works. Now what? So that brought me to a point. So the third point was that, one thing that Aristotle teaches is the golden mean, basically moving away from both extremes and standing in between and understanding that. And so this pursuit of happiness by reaching this golden mean through eudaimonia means that eudaimonia is not something we seek. It's the way of life. It's the way we build our moral character towards a goal. And because of this, it's a lifelong pursuit. Now, because it's a lifelong pursuit of happiness, it is not fleeting. It does not end. It's infinite. And that's the basis of Aristotle's theory of happiness. And so I'll get into the details, but I want to start with an allegory. But the allegory here is the choice of Hercules. I know how many of us have read the Shibasara, because there's this chapter in there that talks about eudaimonia with two men, Areti and what's it, the other name? Anyway, let me tell you what the choice of Hercules is. So now, in this story, Hercules is presented with a choice of two paths, right? One side stands vice, and vice is represented by gorgeous woman. And what this woman offers is a life of immediate pleasure and self-gratification here and now. I must be pleased today. I must be filled today. Kakaya. Yes, Areti and Kakaya. Now, on the other side stands Areti. Areti stands for virtue. So two sides, vice and virtue, who is represented by a more modest woman who promises Hercules a life of challenge, discipline, and moral excellence. Now, when you look at it already, you can see that one is presenting something you can receive now, and the other is just presenting delayed gratification for a reward that will be better in the future. So Hercules, after contemplating the options, chooses virtue over vice. He realizes that true happiness and fulfillment lie not in the pursuit of immediate pleasures, but in the cultivation of virtues. Virtues such as courage, kindness, meaning, family, the willingness to face hardships. And this is what eudaimonia is. You understand that to go through these challenges is how you develop your character. This is how you create your, I call it a eudaimonic bank. Your eudaimonic bank is filled with virtue. So eventually he chooses Areti, and that's how come Hercules is who he is right now mythologically, because he didn't choose the self-gratification in the present. He went through the challenges, even those, what, how do you call those 12?
The
12 trials of Hercules, and then he was raised to God. Again, I want to create that the distinction between contemporary happiness and Aristotle's theory of happiness is that it is not mere pleasure or subjective satisfaction, but it comes from a long-term building of character. It is your lifestyle. So the happiness as a virtuous action, I want to create another understanding for us. Let's say, for example, what is courage, right? You see, if you're standing by the roadside, right, and you see an armed robber holding a knife, you're standing with a woman, and you see an armed robber holding a knife, and he's about to, you know, jack her and take her purse from her, what would you do? Let me actually ask this question. What would you do?
It's armed with a knife.
Yeah.
I mean, your first thing should be to consider whether you can wrestle against someone who is wielding a knife.
And then,
because to see that woman, you might have to disarm the person. Once you end up injuring the woman, probably, and having whatever it is that she is being taken out. Or you are willing to be injured in place of that woman, then you can intervene. However, if you realize that you are in a position where, first of all, you cannot wrestle against somebody who is got in. Second of all, you are not willing to be injured in place of that woman. And the loss of that bag is not as injurious to the woman as you intervening and then causing the aggressor to also injure either you or the woman. Then that would be a basis to tell whether you need intervening.
Okay.
These are the two things that come contextually. Help somebody in that.
So. You have a similar answer?
Yes.
Okay, that makes sense, because actually the some of the critique that comes with eudaimonia is that it is not taught. It's like street sense. You learn it as you go. And that's why it's called the body me, because like you said, it's based on context. If you're at the position where you feel like you can disarm safely the robber and save the woman, then at that time, that's the virtuous thing to do, right? But if you realize that you're in a position where you will cause more harm than good, and you choose to flee, then at that time, that's the virtuous thing to do. So that's what we mean by the golden mean. And that's actually practicing eudaimonia. So let's see, between recklessness and cowardice, that's where courage lies. Between prodigality and stinginess, that's where kindness lies. You understand? So by practicing these virtues, you are actually cultivating a virtuous character. And again, this is what a lot of people in the streets understand, because eudaimonia is street sense. So the importance of reasoning in Aristotle's philosophy, furthermore, is that this pursuit of happiness gives longevity to your pursuit, because it's not something that you can attain and you can lose easily, because it's a building of your character. It causes you to continue to build it. And that's why I brought the quote from Nietzsche that says that he who has a why can bear anyhow, because your character is what is fueling your goal and not the reaching of the goal. Because if your character is fueling the goal and you reach the goal, you will set a new one and then you proceed. And that's why it's a lifelong pursuit. So these are ways that you can live the eudaimonic life. The first one is intellectual pursuit. So actually what we're doing as knowledge maker is eudaimonia. Contributing to the community is eudaimonia. Asking questions when somebody makes a presentation and having contributions, whether they are stupid or not, is eudaimonia. And I was telling somebody something to me that you can only be a fool once. But if you fail to see the stupid thing once and you be a fool, you never learn. Yeah. So these are the activities that we do to build character. And the other things are artistic expressions. And that's what I explained earlier when you made the presentation on logic. Is artistic expression, so music, the arts. A typical example is Da Vinci. Da Vinci was learned primarily in the arts and the way he took things, but he was able to carry over that intelligence into other things, into inventions, to machinery, and all of those things.
Speak up, because it's
exactly. These are things that cause us to live the eudaimonic life. And I want to quote something directly from the book that Aristotle says. He says that, essentially, the form of art is an imitation of reality. It holds the mirror up to nature. There is in a man a pleasure in imitation, apparently missing in lower animals. Yet the aim of art is to represent not the outward appearance of things, but their inward significance. For this, and not the external mannerisms and details, is their reality. There may be more human verity in the sternly classic moderation of Oedipus Rex than in the realistic tears of a Trojan woman. Let me put it differently. There may be more reality in the music that you listen to than somebody just expressing themselves. I will go to give you an example with myself. My transitioning into the space that I am right now because of an album. I listened to Kojo Q's For My Brothers, Rich Dad Poor Dad, Workaholics Anonymous, all of that entire album. And I didn't need anybody to express to me that I needed to put myself in a position to do dope things. That artistic expression caused this character that I'm trying to build within myself
to come forth.
And that's what eudaimonia is. There are other ways to show this forth as well. Meaningful relationships. Nurturing and cultivating deep, meaningful connections with others. Building a strong relationship based on trust, empathy, mutual support. And then if we isolate it some more, the pursuit of virtue, striving to cultivate moral virtues and develop a virtuous character. Now, this can be argued. There are many Christians that have heard that infidelity is wrong, but something that can drive this further for someone is if the person, you cannot do something unless you've put it on yourself to do it, right? So unless you have decided that this is the moral virtue that you seek to pursue, no matter what they say, there's a saying that says that insight is not enough. You might know that you shouldn't do this thing, but knowing that you shouldn't do it is not enough. Unless you are practicing eudaimonia, and one of them is that your pursuit of this virtue is that, okay, this particular thing, I want to do it this way. And it means that now you've accepted that it's not something that's coming from grace. It's not something that's coming from persuasion, even though those contribute at certain points in time. Right? But primarily, you understand that you undergo the hardships of not doing A or B. Those are one of the ways that we do this thing. Another one is self-reflection and personal growth. And this has to do with engaging introspection, meditation, self-reflection, personal development. One of the ways that I know this is great is journaling. Some people journal with books and write it down, but I find that journaling with voice notes is even better for me because you can hear your tone and you can hear the state that you were in when you were journaling that at a certain point in time. And so it gives it a certain distinction. And all of these things are done. But then again, it's important to note that these are only examples and they are not exhausted. Based on you, your strengths, your unique interests, your values, the key is to engage in the activities that you that align with you, you yourself, and contribute to a sense of fulfillment. Okay. So a summary of my points in attaining eudaimonia is, first, the cultivation of virtue, the exercise of reason, striving for the need, meaningful and intrinsically valuable activities, and then fulfillment of your human potential. I want to expand on the human potential a little bit more. Aristotle believed that everything was made for a function. A knife was made to cut. If it does not cut, it's no longer a knife. A spoon was made to fetch. If it cannot fetch anymore, it's no longer a spoon. It might look like a spoon, but if it cannot fetch, it's no longer a spoon. The fig tree must bear fruits. If the fig tree does not bear fruits, it will be cursed and it will wither. The same applies to human beings. If you do not work, if you not do the things that you set to do, you wither. And then you find that this is the balance. This is where you find the balance, that eudaimonia comes because you are doing the things that you are set to do. And then you wither because you do not do the things. And I'd like to end my presentation with this quote that says that life is the gift of nature, but beautiful living is the gift of wisdom. Learn this and build wisdom.